Good morning, Trinity. Woo. That was kind of weak. I know we can do better than that. Good morning, Trinity. I was glad when they said to me, let us go into the house of the Lord. It is indeed a beautiful day outside, and we are thankful for an assortment of things today. One, that there is a bit of a break in the rain. Two, that we have air conditioning because the humidity is, well, you know, South Carolina and it's summer. And one other thing that you may or may not have noticed, but the choir now has a second handrail over here because we have not had that. Well, let's see, I've been coming here for 16 years. For at least 16 years, those steps are not even in the choir loft, so it's a bit of treachery going up and down them, particularly when we come down for communion. And we are so thankful that Bob Wood and Rolf DeSwart made this one to match the one over there and added a top piece to that one so it can be gripped. And the choir is especially thankful. And we appreciate them donating their time and talents for that. It is also very good to have Cindy Baum back and to see Mike up and walking and in church. Yes. He didn't know he was going to be called out as soon as he walked in. There are so many things to be thankful for. We have a new associate pastor, Pastor Julie. Amen. And our Good News class has a presentation for Julie. This is like better than like your birthday month. You know, this is all good.
I'm assuming that God will forgive me because I didn't dress for church. But Julie, we thank you so much for coming and joining our church family here. This is just a little token, and Gary's got a little plant for you. And hang on. And we hope that you enjoy your stay here. We know that we are going to love having you here, and we wish you and your family nothing but good.
Thank you.
And a sad but good but still sad for me personally thing is our pastor's assistant, Peter Underhill, which you have, if you have ever called the church, Peter has the best manners of any person I have ever met. Yes, and that is a lost art. Peter's last day with us is Wednesday. So I'm personally devastated because y'all, I can't tell you how much he keeps me in line here with bulletins and what the choir is doing. But we do wish Peter well in the next part of his journey, wherever that may take him. And here's the presentation. And there's another little something from the Good News class as well. So Peter, if you would please come forward.
Peter, we thank you so much for all that you have done for the church, for the beautiful spirit that is yours, and we wish you all the best in your new ventures. And if you're ever back this way, you better not make yourself a stranger.
Understood.
The Good News class really appreciates everything you've done.
Yes, we should stand up for Peter. There is joy even in times of sorrow, but there is also a whole lot going on in our church. Summer splash, woohoo! Water, coolness, 25th. Mark your calendars, plan to be there. It is for children of all ages. And other children's things. Wiggle Church is going to start back on September 4th. That's the Wednesday after Labor Day. All the children will be in school, so they should also be here. There. Nice and easy. And is that all on my bulletin that I have marked up? It is for now. So with that, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you that we can praise you even in the midst of the storms as new chapters begin. Old ones are closed, and we keep moving forward. Be with us wherever we go, and keep your calm presence with us in the midst of every storm. Amen. Let us go to God.
Let's Please remain standing as we continue to worship and we're greeting, spelling in a bulletin or on a screen. Your part is in bold. Hope nevertheless.
Hope despite.
Hope regardless.
Hope still.
Hope where it we had ceased to hope.
Hope
amid will not threat. Hope with those who feed our hope.
Hope beyond
what we have hoped. Hope that draws us past our limits.
Hope that defies expectations.
Hope that questions what we have known.
Hope that makes a way where there is none.
Hope that takes us past our fear.
Hope that calls us into life.
Hope that holds us beyond death.
Hope that blesses those to come.
Please be seated. Join me in prayer for illumination in your bulletin and on a screen. Let us pray together. God, who we know through the scripture and creation, speak to us where we are. Show us the wisdom and joy of your ways, that we may know what is good and what through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Old Testament reading is Psalm 14, also printed in your bulletin and on the screen. We will read this responsively, and again, your part is in bold. Fool says in their heart, there is no God. The Lord looks down from heaven on all people and to see if there are any that are wise who seek after God. They have all gone astray. They all have lack pursuits. There is none but have they no knowledge? The widower who eat up my people as they eat bread and do not call upon the Lord. For God is the creation of the righteous. You will confound the plan of the poor, but the Lord is their refuge. May God help us continue to apply these holy words to our lives.
My soul.
passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over.
It's time for children's moments. Do we have kids with us today? No kids in here today. Well, I will tell you this. So I'm just going to do it anyway, if that's okay with you, Pastor Scott. We're going to talk about it, right? So we'll all be little children in the Lord today. Oh, my goodness. Here we go. I'm just going to sit down then. Here we go. I love it. Well, we got an audience, so that's wonderful. So we know this book. So we know this book. Green Eggs and Ham. Green Eggs and Ham, a classic by Dr. Seuss. So when I was little, my mom, hi there, Tammy. So my mom literally made green eggs and ham for me when I was little. Now, she called it a quiche. And I was not ready for a quiche. I was used to farm cooking, and I was not ready for a quiche. Mom stepped out. We had spinach and ham, so it was green eggs and ham. And I thought this was the strangest thing on earth. She promised me my favorite pie for dessert if I finished it, and I made my way through. Now, over time, I've become one of the most adventurous eaters that you have ever seen. Bonnie, is that correct? Oh, my. More adventurous than Bonnie is ready for most days. But for instance, because I'm an adventurous eater now, when we're in Thailand, I tried that. Have you all ever seen that before? It's a rambutan. Yes, it looks like it's grown in the ocean, but it is not. It looks like something out of Star Trek. It is, sometime look up rambutan when you get home. It is the wildest looking fruit. And then I had this one, which is a mangosteen. Have y'all ever seen a mangosteen before? I love them so much. It's my favorite food. It's the best fruit you'll ever try. I tried to find it on Amazon, $70 a pound to get it here. Now, it was 25 cents a pound when we were in Thailand, so I ate them by the bushel. But they're incredible. I would never have tried them. Now, I also tried sea cucumber that was just raw sea cucumber. It was just previously alive, and Bonnie was not trying that. Sea urchin, those things. But we never know what we're going to like unless we're just open to try something new. So as we read about green eggs and ham, and we know the story that it's just that call to try something new, to step out in faith and find out what God has for us. Because maybe the way that we've always thought about something, maybe we need to open our minds a little bit. Maybe we need to try something different, right? Because if we try something different, maybe the way that God is calling us into a new way of being, a new way of life, then maybe that's our new favorite thing, the next best thing that he calls us to. And I'll be honest, kids are a lot of times a whole lot better than us at that, right? Us grown-ups, we get stuck in our ways. We figure we know exactly what's right and what's wrong, and we don't like to change our mind or change our opinion about it. But we don't have it all figured out either. And so that's probably a good thing for us to remember too. So thank you all for coming down. Let's pray together. You have been a wonderful group. And so children of all ages, let's pray. And y'all can pray after me. Dear God, thank you for your love. Help us to share your love. Amen. You all can go to children's church if you like. I mean, or you can stay here in big church. So, all right. Thank you all for coming over.
We are all God's children, so it's always a good message to hear for all of us. I want to take a little personal privilege before I start just to bring up a few announcements that just need to be made known. Before the service today, Dick Dager has fallen. He fell in his van trying to get out of the van, but he was inside the van, cut his head. He's on the way to the hospital. And then 20 minutes after that, Ann Williamson fell outside. She's on the way to the hospital herself. So we want to remember her. I mean, the choir, I think, in honor of Ann, and both with Helen not there, with Dick saying that the storm is passing over. We hope the storm has passed over and that it has moved on over us. But we never know when life is going to come at us. So we want to remember both Ann Williamson and her family, and Dick Dager, Helen, and their family. Good morning. Of all the places you could be, Trinity United Methodist Church is where we are this morning. It is good to see you. We are continuing in our sermon series on the gospel according to Dr. Seuss. Now, last week, we looked at how God loves all creatures by looking at one fish, two fish, red fish, blue fish. We looked at how creatures come in all shapes and sizes and forms. Some have 2 feet, 4 feet, and 8 feet. The creatures, they crawl, they walk, and they swim. However they come, Jesus loves them all and their flaws. So whether you have 2, 4, or 8 feet, God still loves you. And he loves all of our flaws. Does not want us to stay there, but he loves us, plain and simple. In Christ, to be unified is to remember, to observe first, and imagine God present here in love. That God is always with us. So whatever we're doing, be mindful that God is present. From there to here and here to there, God's love is everywhere. Now today, we're going to look at new things in God's grace. And we'll look at the book, Green Eggs and Ham. The theme is going to be how quick we are to turn up our noses at something new. We grumble and we complain. Over what? Green eggs and ham? Jesus wants us to try and taste new things. Things that might take us out of our comfort zone. Because what's at stake is more important than our taste buds. It's about doing a new thing for the sake of our neighbor and the sake of the kingdom. Two scriptures I will read to us this morning. First one comes from the prophet Isaiah. This will be the 43rd chapter, verses 18 through 21. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I'm about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches. For I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise. And then from the Gospel of Matthew, the 9th chapter, verses 14 through 17, hear these words. Then the disciples of John came to him, being Jesus, saying, why do we and the Pharisees fast often, but your disciples do not fast? And Jesus said to them, the wedding guests cannot mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them, can they? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast. No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old cloak, for the patch pulls away from the cloak, and a worse tear is made. Neither is a new wine put into old wineskins. Otherwise, the skins burst, and the wine is spilled, and the skins are destroyed. But new wine is put into fresh wineskins, and so both are preserved. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So I thought I'd start off today with some little Dr. Seuss trivia for you. The first book, do y'all know what his first book was? Does anybody know? And to think that I saw it on Mulberry Street was his first book. It was rejected 27 times, but finally published by Vanguard Press in 1937. Now, here's the top 5 best-selling Dr. Seuss books. You will know some of these. Number 5, Oh, the Places You'll Go, was one of his newer books. That was printed in 1990. Dr. Seuss's ABC comes in at number 4. Number 3 is Cat in the Hat. Number 2 is last week's book, One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish. And number 1 is what? Green Eggs and Ham comes in at number 1. That was written in 1960. Now, Bennett Cerf was Dr. Seuss's editor, and he bet him he couldn't write a book using 50 different words or less. The Cat in the Hat used 225 different words. So he took the challenge, and he came up with Green Eggs and Ham, which uses exactly 50 different words. The 50 different words are A, am, and, anywhere, are, be, boat, box, car, could, dark, do, eat, eggs, fox, goat, good, green, ham, here, house. I, if, in, let, like, may, me, mouse, not, on, or, rain, Sam, say, see, think, that, the, them, there, they, train, tree, try, will, with, would, you. 50 words. I just read green eggs and ham. Just like that. So the book is made up of just those 50. Right? So as I was thinking about this, and this story is easy enough to read, a lot of us have heard the story. Maybe we've read it to some of our kids or loved ones or whatever, but maybe you've never had it read to you before. So I'm going to read Green Eggs and Ham to you. So listen up. All right, Audrey, I got to use my singing lung capacity here because it'll take me a while to read this. It'll be quick, but it'll be good. I am Sam. I am Sam. Sam I am. That Sam I am, that Sam I am. I do not like that Sam I am. Do you like green eggs and ham? I do not like them, Sam I am. I do not like green eggs and ham. Would you like them here or there? I would not like them here or there. I would not like them anywhere. I do not like green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam I am. Would you like them in a house? Would you like them with a mouse? I do not like them in a house. I do not like them with a mouse. I do not like them here or there. I do not like them anywhere. I do not like green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam I am. Would you eat them in a box? Would you eat them with a fox? Not in a box, not with a fox, not in a house, not with a mouse. I would not eat them here or there. I would not eat them anywhere. I would not eat green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam I am. Would you, could you, in a car, eat them, here they are. I would not, could not, in a car. You may like them, you will see. You may like them in a tree. I would not, could not, in a tree, not in a car. You let me be. I do not like them in a box. I do not like them with a fox. I do not like them in a house. I do not like them with a mouse. I do not like them here or there. I do not like them anywhere. I do not like green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam, I am. A train, a train, a train, a train. Could you, would you, on a train? Not on a train, not in a tree, not in a car. Sam, let me be. I would not, could not, in a box. I would not, could not, with a fox. I will not eat them in a house. I will not eat them here or there. I will not eat them anywhere. I do not eat green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam, I am. Say, in the dark, here in the dark, would you, could you, in the dark? I would not, could not, in the dark. Would you, could you, in the rain? I would not, could not, in the rain. Not in the dark, not on a train, not in a car, not in a tree. I do not like them, Sam, you see. Not in a house, not in a box, not with a mouse, not with a fox. I will not eat them here or there. I do not like them anywhere. You do not like green eggs and ham? I do not like them, Sam, I am. Could you, would you, with a goat? I would not, could not with a goat. Would you, on a boat? I could not, would not on a boat. I will not with a goat. I will not eat them in the rain, not in the dark, not in a tree, not in a car. You let me be. I do not like them in a box. I do not like them with a fox. I will not eat them in a house. I do not like them with a mouse. I do not like them here or there. I do not like them anywhere. I do not like green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam, I am. You do not like them, so you say. Try them, and you may. Try them, and you may, I say. Sam, if you let me be, I will try them, you will see. Say, I like green eggs and ham. I do, I like them, Sam, I am. I would eat them in a boat, and I would eat them with a goat, and I will eat them in the rain, and in the dark, and on a train, and in a car, and in a tree. They are so good, you see. So I will eat them in a box, and I will eat them with a fox, and I will eat them in a house, and I will eat them with a mouse, and I will eat them here and there. Say, I will eat them anywhere. I do so like green eggs and ham. Thank you, Sam, I am. There you go. You've been read Green Eggs and Ham in church. That's never happened in your life before. Because I've never read it in church before. This story tells the story, it tells a story of Sam, right? Sam I am, who persistently offers green eggs and ham to his friend. Persistently. And this friend is reluctant and refuses to try him. Eventually, his friend gives in and tastes this unusual dish and finds out that he likes it. This whimsical story illustrates the value of being open to a new experience which ties beautifully into what our sermon is today about embracing new things in God's grace. If we look at Matthew 9 that I read, 9:14 through 17, Jesus addresses the disciples of John the Baptist and the Pharisees, and they question the disciples that they are not fasting, that they do not fast. And Jesus responds with a parable about new cloth on an old garment and new wine in old wineskins. He had just been calling his disciples and displaying a different lifestyle to them, right? Early on, he's calling the disciples to him, and he displays a different way of living that they had not seen before. He's not behaving in the manner of John and his disciples. He is not behaving as a Pharisee. He's being Jesus. He's sitting with sinners. He's eating and drinking with them. He's healing the sick and forgiving the sins, way too radical for the Pharisees. Jesus is challenging the status quo. He is not submitting to the way that things should be done. When he is questioned on this, he shares the parable about the cloth and the wineskin. Jesus is declaring there's a new way of life. A new way of life. Jesus came to announce a change in a new way of living. He's explaining to the disciples and the Pharisees that those who want to embrace this new way can't just simply attach what's old onto something new. If they did, it would destroy everything. I believe Jesus is imparting the same message on us today. We are aware that he is doing something new. Now, this is a different time than when Jesus was preaching. Yet we are taking the new revelation he is giving us and trying to attach it to the old way that we have. And we want the new things that God is doing, but we want them to fit in our old ways. How often do we say that, right? We do not want to change or give up the old garment because we like it. It's soft. It's comfortable. It may have a few holes in it, but it's good. It fits us. The challenge is that the new does not match the old. Jesus is saying that the new and old are not in agreement. They cannot abide in the same garment. We so often want to take what we have known from the past and bring it forward, but yet it's a different time. Now, I know that we mean well when we say, I wish we could go back to the good old days. My first question is, were they really good old days? And second, that can never happen, right? Can never happen. Never happen. That's what Jesus says, never happen. Because you're not the same person. If you remembered it when you were five, you're not five now, right? So it's one of those things that we take what was old, we listen to it, but then we move forward. And Jesus says, I've got something new to show you. A new way of life. In a way that I think that we can see this is in baptism. The dying and rising. For immersion is a great way of seeing. You die and you rise to Christ as a new creation, a new person, a new spirit in Christ. We become something else and that we take on all that Christ has given us. I mean, we want to take God with us. We want to have Jesus with us, but we continue to do the old things that we really shouldn't be doing. Some of us over time have let some friends that we had growing up, maybe they've kind of wandered away, or we've wandered away. Or some places we used to go, well, maybe we just don't go there so much anymore or ever. Maybe some of the things we eat or drink, well, you know, at this point in life, maybe it's not going to be the best for me. And we move on from that, right? Because something new happens is that you realize, okay, maybe I'm getting a little more mature. I got to watch my health. I got my relationships. Those become more important than maybe the events, the things, or the people at that time, right? And you realize something far more greater is important. And we get wrapped up in, we sometimes confuse those two. Do you like green eggs and ham? I do not like them, Sam I Am. I do not like green eggs and ham, we keep saying. You ever thought Sam I Am might be God? How persistent he is? Over and over and over asking us if we like green eggs and ham, opening the door to something new? He's coming at us. Sam I Am could be us. Persistently sharing the good news to somebody. Telling people, maybe to our kids, how about that? Yeah, persistently, clean your room. Do you, will you clean your room? Right? Man, if we had a dollar for all that, we'd be rich in here, wouldn't we? Oh my gosh. Jesus reiterates that the idea through the picture of a wineskin, right? When we try to force the new wine into an old vessel, both will be ruined. When we try to put all the new into this old vessel, what happens? It sometimes gets all out of whack. We don't get it all right. We cannot take the new revelation that God is releasing and try to place it in an old vessel. We'll lose the new wine and destroy the old vessel. That's why the wine becomes a little more, it's not really strong. It's not confident. It's not truth. It just becomes a mishmash. Instead, we need a new vessel for new wine. But new wine must be put in new wine skins so both are preserved. The bottom line is if we want new wine, we need to come with a new wineskin. So how do we get that? Well, Jesus is teaching that to fully experience this grace of God, we must be willing to let go of old traditions and practices that cannot contain the new transformative power of Jesus' message. We have to let go of that stuff. Isaiah brings up a good point about forgetting the former things. He encourages us to forget these former things and not dwell on the past because God is doing a new thing. God is doing a new thing. Forget the former things. It doesn't mean to ignore history or our past or our experiences, but rather not let them limit our vision for the future. It would be quite easy for me, having two of our members had ambulances called on the same day, right before preaching, that would take me out off my game. But you can't let that happen, right? There's something important that has to be done. And we have to follow through with that, regardless of whether our heart wants to be somewhere else. And we have those moments where we have to say, we can remember, but we have to do what's important in front of us. And this is the most important thing that I can do, is what I'm doing. Because God is doing a new thing. The new thing springs up, and we are to perceive it. Do you see it? God makes a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland, demonstrating his power to bring life and hope in the most desolate circumstances. God is doing a new work in all of you and all of us. He's doing a wonderful work in us. I would challenge us in this work as we forget the former things, remember and keep moving forward, to embrace the things that are difficult. Now, in the middle of it, you're not going to embrace it. It's going to be hard. But when you embrace that, you might discover that's where the new thing lies, where it's the hardest, where it's the most difficult, right? Where the intersection happens, where it moves and moves together and is tough and hard. But in there, something new and powerful can happen because it reassures us that God's grace is constantly renewing and transforming our lives. And he invites us to participate in it. We get to do this. Now, Green Eggs and Ham. I think that that story opens us up to God's surprises. The reluctant friend, his initial refusal to try something new, mirrors our own resistance to change and try new experiences. It's hard. It's hard to change. Just this past week, the staff took Peter out to lunch, but for the first time, Julie had a Chubby burger from Chubby's restaurant. He had never tried that. That was something new for her. She would eat it in a house, and she would eat it with a mouse, right? It was good, wasn't it? Here, they are anywhere, she'd eat it, right? And so it was something new for her. And it was like, oh my gosh, it's a new experience. Where has this burger been all my life? No, I don't get any money from promoting them, but if you are hungry, I think they're open on Sundays. I'm just saying. So, but you tried something new. A lot of times trying something new in a group of people can be an opportunity, right? That you have others around you to kind of help you and to see, oh, well, they're trying it. Maybe I can try this too, right? Sam's persistence is really akin to God's persistent grace, right? To try something new, to invite us to step out of our comfort zone and embrace the newness. Julie embraced the newness of a new burger somewhere she'd never been before. New place. So how often have you gone to someplace new? When you've traveled around the country or the world, you go new for the first time, and you're like, wow, you got to get used to a lot of things that are different, right? Sometimes it's the language, sometimes it's the money, sometimes it's the way, what side of the road you're driving on, and which way you're going, and up and down, and figuring all this out. And you're not sure which way is which. But what? When you get your bearings, you feel like you own it, right? Oh, I know how to do this. I know where I'm going now enough to get by. And that's what God is doing to us. He's offering us this grace and invites us to step out. He's inviting us if we're reluctant to change. The character, our friend, refuses to try green eggs and ham, but we often resist change and new opportunities because we fear the unknown. We're afraid. We think it's going to be like this. And most of the time we discover, wow, it isn't all that bad. Persistence of grace. God, like Sam I Am, does not give up on us. Praise God for that. We might give up on each other. Others might give up on us. But God never gives up on us. Never. He will be persistent over and over and over by giving his grace. And to embrace our new experiences where we take that step of faith and embrace the new things God offers. It brings us joy and fulfillment and a deeper relationship with him. That's happening here at Trinity. I know some of our Sunday school classes and connection times, there are more than enough people fitting in a room that you gotta expand that. Where are we going to put people? How are we going to embrace new relationships that are being built? How are we going to work with families and children and helping them along the way to offer them some green eggs and ham that we can be persistent over and over and over, right? Because in the end, Sam I Am can be us. And remember, all the new experiences don't have to only affect you. They may actually be for somebody else. But you're the bearer of the information that you get to share to somebody else. Which would be me. I'm sharing and bearing, hey, there's new experiences for you. I may not know what they are for you, but I know that they're there. So just because you receive it doesn't mean it's necessarily for you. It may be for someone else. And so we take this with kids' glove and hold on to it and say, this is something that God has given me to take care of. And then we're persistent to share with our friends or family or neighbors that, you know, don't be like Sam I Am and just over and over and over again, but be persistent enough to let people know that Jesus is your Lord and Savior and that you will stand and die on that. All right. How many of us would really stand and die on that? I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. Because you might raise your hand in here, but I'll catch you during the week. And you may ask me, and I may not raise my hand either. Right? Right. So, but that's why we need to try new opportunities. That's why God continues. I think that's part of the way that God is teaching us, is that we have an opportunity to try something new that we never would have tried before. I see Arlene and Stuart thinking about Salkehatchee, right? When you do Salkehatchee, there are people who've never been before to work on homes, never been in a home that we would call trash, and someone there calls their home. To go in and to work and to struggle, but to find love and grace that you can't find in the most beautiful places on earth. You can find it there and in the midst of that home. And that comes from God. Because God's grace is ever present and invites us to embrace the new and transformative work he's doing in our lives. Transformation, that's what it's about. Transformation takes time. Doesn't happen overnight. Will take your lifetime. We're all transforming. None of us get there on this side. We try. We'll always be transforming. So embrace things that are new. Just as our friend in Green Eggs and Ham discovers a new favorite food, we can discover the richness of life in Christ by being open to new things he is doing. What is he doing in your life? What's new? And there's some people, there's a couple in the first service who are getting ready to be grandparents for the first time. Something new is happening. Some of you are celebrating birthdays, anniversaries, whatever that is. There's something new. You've never been that age before. Guess what? No one's lived the rest of this day before. That means there's a new opportunity for us, right? God is doing something new. We get to participate in it. And we get to kind of help guide some of that because all we can control is ourselves. May we be open to his surprises and be ready to experience the fullness of God's grace. I do so like green eggs and ham. Thank you, Sam, I am. Let's pray. Oh, good and gracious God, we are thankful for this day and the opportunities that you have afforded us to bring us here today to hear your word with celebrations and thankfulness for jobs well done, for new appointments, for opportunities for all of us to grow and to live beyond our wildest dreams. God, most of us wouldn't have dreamed we'd be where we are just a few short years ago. But here we are, being transformed by your word. We pray, oh God, that we have eyes to see and ears to hear as you are persistent, as Sam I am, teaching us about the good news of Jesus the Christ, about humility, about love, and about grace, and about hope. For God, we seek those things. We seek what is good and right and true. I know, God, we live too much in our past. We want to go back or we want to bring forward something from the past. But God, it doesn't work. It does for a little while, but that new wineskin, that old wine, it just isn't what we need. So God, I pray for each person who can hear my voice in this room and online that your transformative power continues to work in us. We can take this moment to thank you for who you are, Almighty God, and to give us that strength and power, put something new in front of us, a new experience where there's a difference that can be made. Not only in our lives, but someone else's life. That we in your church can be a beacon of hope where many are just lost and wayward. And they don't know this transformative work, God, that we speak of today. They just walk aimlessly. But we know it. And we can be like Sam I am, God, and we can share this. We can be persistent in whatever comfortability we may have, but let's challenge ourselves, God. Challenge us to invite folks to come to worship, to invite folks to our Sunday school classes and connection time, to invite folks to the events that we have at church, to invite us to maybe go out to dinner or to have a group or to go to a movie or a play or do many different things. We love our friends. But wouldn't it be better if there were more along? Where new thoughts and ideas and experiences come? We can learn about other cultures and other families and realize, God, you are mighty and powerful. I've learned something new. And for that, we'll be better off. And our world will change. We pray a change for the better. Oh Lord, as we continue through this service and on into the day ahead of us, we pray for those who are hungry and homeless and hopeless. We pray for those among us who are continuing to heal from ailments, that strength be their friend and hope be their guide, and that grace be their support. Lord, you've done so much for us. And sometimes we just don't say thank you enough. But today, oh God, we as your people lift up a hallelujah and thank you for all that you've done and all that you will continue to do for us. Now continue to journey with us as we go. We do like green eggs and ham. Yes, we do. Sam, I am. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now stand and profess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. As we give back to God as a discipline, a spiritual discipline of who we are and what we do, is prayer and scripture and worship and all the relationships that we form, let us give back to God all that he has blessed us with, because he has given us more than we can even imagine. He's given us what we need. Sometimes we want more, but we definitely have all we need. God, we give these gifts back to you, for they were yours before they were ours. We pray that you will multiply them in our presence, so that your kingdom may be built both within our hearts and in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is Softly and Tenderly Jesus is Calling. Jesus is calling all of us. He is persistent, like Sam I am. He is persistent. Let us have ears to hear, eyes to see, hearts that are open. Next week, we're going to look at There's a Wocket in My Pocket as the book. We're going to see what Dr. Seuss is going to say and how he will teach us, actually how the gospel of Christ teaches us. But Dr. Seuss is kind of that vehicle that will lead us out into the world. Go in peace to love and serve our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ this day and always. Amen.